One of the greatest days in history. Amen. Our King is risen. Hallelujah. Here we go. As we come today, we remind ourselves of what we do. That these songs are not just songs, but signs of love for you. This is a holy moment. This is a holy moment now. Something of heaven touches earth. Voices of angels all resound. We join their song. Come, come, come. Let us worship God with our hands held high and our hearts bowed down. We will run, run, run through your gates, O God, with a shout of love, with a shout of love. Sing with Lord with confidence. Though with confidence we come before your throne of grace. Not that we deserve to come, but you have paved the way. You are the holy King of all. Heaven and earth are in your hands. All of the angels sing your song. We join them now. Come, come, come. Let us worship God with our hands held high and our hearts bowed down. We will run, run, run through your gates, O God, with a shout of love, with a, one more time, sing, come, come, come. Come, come, come. Let us worship God with our hands held high and our hearts bowed down. We will run, run, run through your gates, O God, with a shout of love, with a shout of love. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Sing, I'm forgiven because you were forsaken.
And I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. And I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me. Because you died.
I'll sing that again. I'm forgiven.
And I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. And I'm accepted. You were condemned. And I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me. Because you died and rose again.
Sing amazing love.
Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true. And it's my joy to honor you in all I do. I'll honor you.
Sing, I'm forgiven.
And I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. And I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me, because you died and rose again.
Amazing love.
Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true, and it's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor, sing, you are my King. You, my King. Jesus, you are my King. You are my King. Jesus, you. All I sing that again. You are my King. You are my King. Jesus, you are my, you are my King. You are my King. Jesus, you are, I'll sing amazing love. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true, and it's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor. Oh, let's give God praise today. Lord, we thank you. Lord, we honor you.
Praise your name. Thank you, God. We give you all the praise tonight. Thank you. God, we thank you for your love. God, we thank you for your mercy. God, we thank you for your unfailing love. Amen. Amen. I'm so thankful for amazing love. I don't know if we completely understand God's great love, but I love that he loves us. While we're still sinners, Christ died for us. Bible says that when we were lost, that he loved us. And I think that's something about love, is that it's love is beyond the circumstances and the situations. And so we want to pray tonight in this atmosphere of worship. We want to pray for those that need love, that need God's grace, they need a miracle in their life. Our sister Julie in our church, she has a friend named Dean that is in a really dark place in his life, and he's really battling some of those deep dark thoughts. And we want to pray for Dean. We want to pray, lift him up, and we're going to pray that God would touch his life and reach down and rescue him. He's struggling today. We want to pray that God would help him. Maybe tonight you know somebody, or maybe you even here, you're going through a time. And you say, I need a miracle. I need God to help me. What better day to reflect on what God can do than Resurrection Day, when something is absolutely dead to be back to life. And so God can do it again. And that's what he does, and that's what we're here for. Let's pray tonight. God, we just thank you so much for your power. God, for your mercy, for your grace. God, we thank you that you are the unfailing God, the miracle-working God, the God of heaven and earth, the God who loves us. God, that you desire, God, that you say, come before my throne of grace. God, we come boldly tonight, humbly, God, grateful that you love us. God, we pray that you touch Dean tonight. God, we ask that you would rescue him. God, we pray that you would help him in his thoughts and his heart. God, we pray that you lift this depression, God, whatever lies of hell that have been spoken into his heart and his mind be broken in Jesus' name. God, we pray that you would set him free tonight by the blood of Jesus, God. We pray tonight. We ask, God, that you would move in our circumstances, situations, whether it be finances, whether it be healing in our bodies. We pray, God, that you would touch every life and every situation, our friends, family. God, we pray that you would move in our churches, and we pray tonight that you would bless this time. We ask, God, that you would bless Pastor Ralph as he preaches. God, we thank you that we can come into your house and worship you in Jesus' name. And all God's people said,
Amen. Amen. Tell somebody that you love them. Tell them you're glad to see them in church tonight. Amen. Find somebody. Tell them that you're glad to see them. Tell them you're grateful to see them here. Welcome to church tonight. Amen. Good to see everybody. Praise the Lord. What a beautiful sunset this evening. Amen. I love it after it rains and everything's beautiful, clean, and the sky looks great. Praise the Lord. It's good to be in church. Well, we just wanted to touch on a few quick announcements. Remember, this week we have prayer meetings. We have prayer meetings Monday through Saturday in the mornings. There is a Thursday night prayer meeting that's just begun at 6 p.m. The 3 p.m. Monday afternoon prayer meeting, I believe, is postponed till next week because school's out. But also, we have prayer before our services, our evening services. So those are our prayer meetings. We do have church on Wednesday night. And make sure you check our website because there's a lot of connect groups that are taking place, a lot of events that take place. And we can't list them all, but there's a lot of opportunities to be involved. I want to take a moment to give an opportunity. We want to take tithes and offerings tonight, or receive tithes and offerings, because it's never something that we take. It's something that we freely give. But, you know, Sunday, the reason why we come to church, a lot of people, you know, wonder why, you know, the Sabbath day is Saturday and Sunday is why we always have church services. And it seems kind of like a conflict. But in light of what today means, today is Resurrection Day. So this is the day that we celebrate new life. So the old covenant is not necessarily gone, but there is a new covenant that God brings. And so we celebrate the first of a new life. So the Bible says that the 7 days of, you know, creation, 6 days of creation, the seventh day God rested, that would be Saturday. And the eighth day, or the first day all over again, or the eighth day, is Resurrection Day. So the number eight, or Resurrection Day, is a day of new beginnings. It's a new life. It's a new experience. And so today is a day of celebration. This isn't a day of stop and resting. This is a day of let's go for God. God is awesome. That's why we worship on Sunday. So it's kind of a cool perspective, and it's an interesting idea. And, you know, over the years, you know, people have made really serious doctrines about it, but, you know, we worship God today. We celebrate because it's Sunday. But in that light, the first people to experience resurrection power and resurrection life were the ones who came to give at the tomb. So the Bible says that the women came, and Peter and John, they came to anoint the body. So on the third day, this is the day after the Sabbath, they came to take care of the body because Jesus died, he was buried. It was the Sabbath day, they couldn't work. And so the eighth day, or the first day, the resurrection day, they came to anoint the body. And those that came to give were the first people to experience resurrection. Isn't that interesting? And I find it very powerful that when we give, we experience God. The Bible says, give and it'll come back to you, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over. The Bible says, this is what God did, for God so loved the world that he gave. And giving is a characteristic of God, and we'll experience God as we practice who he is in our life. And so that's why we have this chance to give every service, because this is an opportunity for us to experience God. So ushers, please come forward tonight as we receive our tithes and offerings. Amen. Praise the Lord. Zeke, putting you to work tonight, buddy. Amen. Aren't you thankful for Zeke? It's a good. All right. We're glad that Zeke's been getting pretty good on the guitar. So, Zeke, please pray.
Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for another night that we get to be alive with that God. Thank you that you gave your son for us. I pray that you'd help us to take a step of faith and give to your kingdom. And I pray that you'd bless the gift and the giver. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Tonight we have an incredible privilege. We don't really get to recognize it very often, but Pastor Ralph Bowen is, in our little world that we live in, one of the great heroes of our faith. He has been a missionary for decades, and he quietly, humbly serves our church and is a blessing as he ministers here. And we are so grateful for his perspective and for his attitude and his love for God and for our church. And so let's give him a big hand as he comes and preaches, Pastor Ralph Bowen.
This means I can't have a bad attitude, so. Anyway, how many of y'all ever had a bad attitude? Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Just a little tidbit of things to say. Our churches in Africa are doing well. We have some new building projects going on. The church in the Gambia has this huge upstairs room, and now they've expanded their school, so the Lighthouse was able to help them with some of the funding, and they're starting to build new partitions and open up new classrooms in the upstairs of the Gambia Lighthouse Church. Hallelujah. And so we're glad about that, and we just thank God for all that is going on there. Thank you for giving when you do, and God has great things in store. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. So let's turn our hearts tonight. How many of you have like random things happen in your life and that you always just wonder why? You know, you've seen the little bumper sticker that says, you know, perform random acts of kindness, you know. So, but there are random things that happen in life. And much of what the scripture is all about is like God taking all these stories of people's lives that you see. There's this sort of organic feel of the stories of people in the Bible that just come together because God's able to orchestrate things beyond what we can imagine or think, in spite of whatever's happened. I mean, I wear contact lenses, so I often drop them and lose them, and so I pray, and I randomly find them. Randomly find them. The other day, I was putting my contact lens in the case, and it dropped into a backpack that's hanging on the thing, and I was searching all over the floor, and I thought, okay, well, there's the backpack. I open up, there's my contact lens. Hallelujah. There's little random things happen. Amen? I have two sets of keys that are master lock keys that I open up the preschool, and I've got two identical keys, and I have no idea which one is which. So I play this little game, you know, if I pick the right one first, God is really with me. So I'm in there, and I turn that key, and then it works. Oh, God, thank you. That's great. You know, this random act of something that God has orchestrated and put it together just for me. Amen. And sometimes we go along in life, and we wonder about all those random acts of things that happen, and somehow congeal together at the end of it. I've lived 65 years now, and it's you can look back on a life that long, and you know, there's some others of us here that have lived that long, and you can see that God somehow has orchestrated events and chance and things that happen in our lives. The Bible says, Ecclesiastes 9, verse 11 through 12, that chance and time happen to all. And the race is not to the swift nor to the strong, but time and chance happen to all. And that people can be caught up in a net like fish in a net in the courses of history. We lived in Africa for a while, and people were caught up in the net of rebel war. They didn't want it. They didn't ask for it, but just randomly somehow this evil had come upon them, and now they are caught up in a bad situation. And all kinds of stuff has happened to them in their lives. How many of you have situations where stuff has happened to you and it's been a random thing and it wasn't like something you did wrong? You know, sometimes when you have to think about this, when we get saved from things that have happened to us. Not only the things that we have decided to do wrong, but we get saved from the things and the effects of things that have happened to us, be they random or whichever. But there's a disorder in the universe. Can you say amen? There is a disorder of things going on, and you and I, we can know that those kinds of things happening are somehow hopefully going to work out. And sometimes you don't even know. You don't even know. Like when you get a box that's a shipped item of something you have to assemble, there's all kinds of random packaging. And you sit there and look at it. Oh, okay, well, there's a reason why. There's a reason why these things have been sort of put together this way. And that's why they pack the box this way, because in shipping, it's going to get messed up. And I see that happening. And the Bible, and this is just a plug for the Bible. The Bible is something you should read if you've never read it before. Open it up, because it is a book that takes random events in people's lives, and it takes what would seemingly be haphazard, crazy stuff in people's personal lives, and God is telling a story of reaching humanity. And that's powerful, because God is reaching out to us in spite of everything else that's going on. And when we get down to the end of this sermon tonight, I hope that you're going to find some encouragement, because many of us, we have things that have happened. We're walking down memory lane, and we're looking at things that seem odd and obtuse and sort of out of the ordinary in the Bible. And I think, to me, that makes it even more authentic, because it's not like some glorious mythological story of something told wonderfully and blah, 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 and where there's rainbows and unicorns and everybody's eating organic food. You know, it's not like that. The Bible is hardcore reality. And if you read it, you'll find out that God, in all of that, He's doing and He's moving and He's making something happen. Can you say amen? Praise the Lord. The whole story of the Bible is situations in the very beginning. The Bible says that when God created the heavens and the earth was without form. It was chaotic. And then God spoke and said, let there be light. And this is somehow the actual story of our lives. God spoke and said, let there be light. And something good happened. The whole story of the children of Israel is a very interesting story, because it is a story of people that were just a small group. Even in Isaiah 49, verse 6, the Bible says, it is too small a thing that I will redeem you, O Jacob, but I will make you a light unto the Gentiles. So God has a way in all the stories of the Bible, taking something that is kind of small, obtuse, you would never imagine it to be something grand, but all of a sudden it turns out to be the grandest thing there is. Can you say amen? In Deuteronomy 7, verse 7, the Bible says that God did not choose Israel because they were more numerous in number than any other nation. He chose them. They were small. There was a targeted reason why God throughout history has flip-flopped the natural way people think. That's the way God always has operated. Even the story of Jacob. I want to do a study on Jacob. Jacob is like the guy who's in the school of hard knocks. He just doesn't kind of get it sometimes. And he does stuff just like everybody else does, and doesn't really cultivate any sort of relationship with God until at the very, very latter part of his life, he's learned some things. He had some, hard things and lessons to learn. In the latter part of his life, he's there prophesying. He has a real relationship with God. And so I'm here to tell you that, there are a lot of stories throughout the Bible where God turns it around. Like the story where in Genesis 25, verse 23, the Bible speaks about Rebekah getting this this word from God. She said, if everything's cool and everything's good with me, then why am I, you know, why am I having this struggle? Because she had twins, and there was some movement, you know, that was unusual for her and her twins. I wouldn't know. But she asked that question, and God gives her a prophecy about it. And then later on in her life, she's trying to manipulate situations to make it happen because she can't handle the chaos. And this is sometimes what happens to us. When there is chaos, there are things that are, you know, not like we would want them to be. All of a sudden, we start at work about trying to bring order and bring order out of chaos and bring things into some sort of similitude of, you know, this works, or trying to make it happen, you know. But the Bible is like that. It's a story from the beginning to the end. God does things completely differently than what man thinks. The Bible says his thoughts are higher than our thoughts. It's just an amazing thing. Jesus said, my kingdom is not of this world. And so there's something that's way beyond what we can imagine or think that's going on. There's another thing happening. We get so focused on here and now. And that's why the story of the resurrection is like a personal earthquake. If you believe in the resurrection of Jesus Christ, it for you is a personal earthquake. It is something that just shatters everything. Imagine seeing Jesus alive again after you've actually saw him die. Now, many of my Muslim friends back where I lived in Africa, they have this idea that, you know, after the Bible got translated into Arabic, you know, they had all this idea in their mind. They would say, well, the Bible's the same as the Quran, and it's all the same. But when they finally got the Bible translated into Arabic and they read it, they got, it's not the same. And so they began to try to work around it. So they say, one of the things was that God would not allow such a good person like Jesus to die, such a terrible death. And God put somebody else there instead of Jesus. And this is what they tell you. This is what they believe. And they have all kinds of little things like that. And sometimes we make up things to try to, like, you know, get around the fact that God's really got something going on. We kind of think our world should be picture perfect. I should have been raised perfectly. I should have never had to struggle with poverty or someone with drunkenness in the family. I should have never had to deal with all of these things, you know. But at the end of the day, nobody's life or family background is perfect. We're all just a bunch of sinners. Come on, right? We're all just who we are. And God still loves us, and he wants to give us a personalized earthquake tonight. Can you say amen? I don't know about you, but I always wanted, you know, my life to be just right, right? There was a song written by one of the hippie-turned-Jesus movement person, Annie Herring. She wrote a song, I always wanted my life to look like the right side of a tapestry. But darkness was weaved in when I was conceived in iniquity, and I want to be cut free. I don't understand it. I'll never understand it, what you've gone through. You took me out of hell when you tore through my veil, and now all I can do is just look at you. And there's something about it, you know, the backside tapestry of your life and my life, it isn't pretty. It isn't in order. It doesn't have a sense of, you know, everything's in its right place. It isn't like that. And we know that. And there are times where our own sin, time and chance, and all these things come together and they start messing up our lives. But if we would just take one moment and repent, one moment of honesty with Christ, one moment of honesty with Jesus changes your whole life. One simple moment of acknowledging, God, this doesn't look good. That's my personal testimony. I was going to church because my sisters went to church. I had no idea about anything about church, God, heaven, or hell. I didn't even know. They started talking about the rapture. I thought they were nuts. And I went to church for a while. I said, okay, read the Bible. So I started reading the Bible, and all of a sudden, uh-oh, my life isn't right. And my life wasn't what it was supposed to be. And I got scared of being without God when I died. So I prayed and asked Christ to come into my life. And then looking back on our lives, you and I, when we look back, you know, and we've heard the verse in Romans chapter 8, verse 28, all things work together for the good of those that love God and are the called according to his purposes. All things work together for good. That means all the backside of the tapestry works together for the good of what God has called you for. The thing is, do you want to follow what God has called you for? If you and I want to follow what God has called us for, we're going to really, really find the blessing of God. In Romans 8, Paul says these things. In chapter 8, verse 31, he goes on, he says some very significant things. He says we're going to start not at 31. We're going to go down and we're going to start let's just start at verse 38. I will just start there. He says, for I am persuaded. Now, just notice the phrase, I am persuaded. Are you persuaded tonight? Am I persuaded? Because you have to be persuaded. It's not, you're not born a Christian. You're not born somebody who is saved. You can be raised in church and still be a dirty, rotten little sinner. You're not born a good, you know, a good, perfect being, okay, that deserves heaven. That's what the Bible teaches us. Yeah, there might be something that might be good about us, but, you know, ultimately, you know, one sin does not exist in heaven. So how many, you know, maybe you sinned one time. Well, that's enough. That's enough to block the doors. But Paul, he says, I am persuaded. And so he's been convinced, and he's been given, you know, this sort of assurance that nothing is going to separate him. Nothing is going to convince him otherwise that's going to change his mind. And he says, I am persuaded that neither height nor depth, nor principalities nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height nor depth, nor any other thing. And you can just say, even himself, Paul himself, the goofball I look at in the mirror, you know, that person cannot separate me from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Can you say amen? So here's Paul persuaded that nothing of discouragement, nothing of his past, if there's anybody you think of that maybe could have just sort of curled up in a ball and just said, I want to die, it would be Paul. It would be Paul because he persecuted the church. The Bible gives a history of him, you know, standing there and consenting to the death of Stephen the martyr. And he's there also going about searching to find Christians to put them away. So this was Paul. It's like he was the antithesis of the church, the enemy of the church. And then he has an experience. He had his earthquake. He had an earthquake. He had a personal earthquake. And you read about that in the book of Acts. And he is convinced. And he wasn't going to just crawl away and hide. The Bible tells us in Galatians that he spent 14 good long years in fellowship with Christ and God and getting things in his heart and his life right. It took something to convince him. And now, and you see all the things that he's written in the New Testament, all of that is the culmination of somebody who had a real encounter with God. You and I, we've had some encounters with God. Can you say amen? There's some of you here, you know that God has done some good stuff in your life. And nothing is going to convince you otherwise. Nothing is going to change that. No chaos or anything is going to change that. And it gets me down to just the blessing of having people in your life. My mother-in-law, Janet Baker, she has just passed this past week ago, a week and a half ago, and she was in an assisted living home. She was just a wonderful mom, a very sweet, endearing person. Always had chocolate cookies for us, chocolate cake, and every time we would go to visit her in Florida from our trips from Africa, and we would go, and it was like, you know, it's such a time of relaxing and just such a wonderful time. She was that kind of lady, and her and I, we'd sit out on the veranda in her back porch area, and she lived on a canal there in Florida in Satellite Beach, and she had her Bible there, and she was reading her Bible, and she and I, we would talk in the early mornings, because Brenda was still asleep. You know, she was, oh, nice, relaxing, I'm at Mommy's house, you know, so she and I would sit in the back, at the back of the house there, and it's just a random moment, and we would talk, and she'd be in tears explaining some new thing she found in the Bible. You know, this was in her latter life, and she was such a blessing. And I can remember out of the blue, she would just write these short little letters to us in Africa. We would go to the mail, P.O. Box 10 in Kabbalah, Sierra Leone, West Africa, and there's a little letter from my mother-in-law, and it was always funny because she would say, "Nothing new here. It rained today. You know, made cookies. Saw Charlie and Matt. God bless you." You know, but she would come up. She would say some funny little things once in a while. But it's just random encouragement that would come. And it's because she was convinced and she was persuaded. And she was very proud of her daughter for being on the mission field and doing what she did. And you know, the whole Easter story is kind of like that. There's a lot of random, chaotic stuff that happened during the Passion Week, in the time when Jesus was sought after to be the Messiah, and then all of a sudden the crowds who are crying out, "Hosanna," and the next week they're saying, "Crucify him." Such chaos, such randomness. Such confusion. But the Bible and the Gospels are written in such a way that you get from it the real story. These are the people, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, these are the ones who ate with Jesus, they walked with Jesus, they listened to him, they were there, they were eyewitnesses, and they saw these things happen. And, you know, so the Bible and the story of the resurrection is not just some little bland story that we read about on, you know, the springtime and there's bunnies and there's flowers and all of that. No, this is an earthquake matter. This changed history. This has changed people's lives and it's made all the difference. And it's not some myth. You know, there are people that would say, you know, well, the Bible is just some sort of created myth. All of these stories the disciples had to kind of think up, you know. But the interesting thing was that, I don't know if you ever heard of Chuck Colson. He was one of the criminals involved in the Watergate scandal in the United States. And he said, "I know the resurrection is a fact. And Watergate proved it to me." How? Because 12 men testified they had seen Jesus raised from the dead. Then they proclaimed the truth for 40 years, never once denying it. Every one of them beaten, tortured, stoned, and put in prison. They would not have endured that if it weren't true. Watergate embroiled 12 of the most powerful men in the world, and they couldn't keep alive for 3 weeks. So you're telling me 12 apostles could keep alive for 40 years? Absolutely impossible. So he was pretty convinced, I would say. And it's a convincing thing to know that the Gospels are not some sort of story just written around, you know, oh, maybe it happened, maybe it didn't. C.S. Lewis, he wrote, he said he was a great expert in literature of mythology. He was like the doctorate of it. You know, he was the doctor of professor and the fellowship that spoke and taught all that stuff in the British colleges there, the universities. But he said this: those who think that the Gospels are myths haven't read many myths. And that's because the Gospels just grab you and take you into the real events, the things that happened, the random stuff that just came down on Jesus, the things that just sort of, you know, some people tried to accuse Jesus of saying, well, you know, he manipulated everything because he did this. He went and got a donkey for fulfilling the scriptures and wanted to do this. But the reality is Jesus, he didn't go up and rip the curtain in two in the temple. He didn't cause the earthquake to happen. You know, there's so many things. He didn't tell the soldiers to gamble for his clothes. He didn't say, oh, you guys down there, okay, gamble for my clothes now. No, he and all these random things that were going about and happening, it was meant to be, and God orchestrated it. And that's why when you read the Bible, you're hearing good news, because it's news. It's the news event. It's what really happened. And you and I are not going to be able to get around it, because personally, I don't want to get around it. And you can't. C.S. Lewis was a man who was an agnostic person, and he wanted to disprove the Bible. He wanted to disprove Christian faith. And so as he studied, he began to realize, no, wait a minute. There's too much evidence. This is true. This is true. So if that's true, if all of that is true, then maybe I should listen to God when he says all things can work together for the good of my life. God can work all random chaos and things that have happened and bring those things to pass in my life and make something happen and something good in my life. You see, God is the only one who is capable of taking all the missed targets that we've fired and making it happen where we can do a redo. Hello. I hope you understand that. God is the only one who can take all the stuff, and with just one honest moment with him, you can get to do a redo. You can get to have him take your life and use your life. He's the supernatural overrider of all the things that sort of turned into a mess in my life and in your life. He can do that because he has the power to do that. I don't know if you've ever read the story of the crucifixion and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. When Jesus Christ died on the cross, the Bible says the earth quaked. And then the Bible says there were graves of saints and people before that were broken open, and they came alive again. And it says that they visited and talked with people in the city. It was a very, very different time. When that happened, those kind of things happening, what would you think? If you had a personal encounter with God in some sort of way like that, wouldn't it mean you were convinced? And all of those disciples, they were convinced. And they went to a martyr's death, preaching the gospel throughout different places through the world. So there's kind of like this way that God brings together things. And tonight, I just believe that God wants to bring together some things in your life. And it's usually what's between your ears. It's what's between our ears. The struggle we have that, you know, my life didn't make it. I'm not doing what I should do. Or, you know, I messed up too bad that God can't use me or God can't accomplish something for my life. You know, there's a tradition. There's an old tradition that says Peter, the Apostle Peter, anytime he heard the cock crow or a rooster crow, that he would weep. He'd fall down and weep. You know, I don't know if that's true, but I think at some point, you know, you see the rest of Peter's life. He went on. He wasn't just fixed and stopped at that point. Paul, also, he went on and did something else for God. So no matter where any of us have come from, maybe you've been in church for a long time in your life, but, you know, maybe you've backslidden really terrible. You know, that's the story of my life. And when you come back to God and you're serious with God, he's serious with you, he'll take you and use you. And there's nothing better than to be able to be an instrument of God using your life. Can you say amen? There's a lot of people out there experiencing random stuff coming against them. They're hurt. They need help. And we've got Jesus, and we're going to give it to him. Can you say amen? We're going to give it to him. We're going to help them. We're going to talk to people. This is a season. We're going to go out and talk to people and be part of their lives and encourage them that God can turn it all around. I want to close with one scripture in Genesis chapter 50, verse 20. You know the story where Joseph was hauled off to Egypt and was thrown into prison. And all that transpired in his life, his brothers come back and they're all there now. Everything that randomly happened to Joseph that was what we would say is very bad, he looks at it in a different way. And he says, but as for you, you meant evil against me, talking of his brothers, the story of Joseph. But God meant it for good in order that he wanted to bring about, as it is to this day, to save many people. There are many people who need to be saved. And the random stuff that's happened to you and I can be a tool to help them. Or maybe you're here tonight and you're not in any condition or feel like I can help anybody. That's okay, because God can help us. God can help you right now. God can deal with all the random stuff in your life right now and touch you and bring you to a place where you are assured, you are persuaded, like Paul, who said, I am persuaded that nothing can separate me from the love of God. How many of you want that tonight? Who wants to, you know, make sure that you are not separated from the love of God? That's me. I don't want to ever, go without the love of God. And, you know, sometimes, I know my mind isn't always working right or thinking the right thoughts, you know, and you have to check yourself. And sometimes you say the wrong things or you're absent of saying the right thing. You know, there's all kinds of things we can do. But you know what? God tonight is here in this place. And I believe the Holy Spirit is right here, right now, and he's able to do something. I want us to bow our heads and close our eyes because God wants to transform people's lives tonight. He wants to move in your life. You might have had difficulties with your upbringing. Maybe choices you made. Maybe choices people made against you. Whatever the random chaos might have been, there is a resurrection. There is a resurrection. Jesus Christ is alive, and he's able. And the Bible says, he came to seek and to save that which is lost. And many of us have been battered and abused by the world. But tonight, I believe God has an answer, and he has the ultimate answer for your life. He wants to bring all the chaos and everything that was out of order, he wants to bring it back to you and bring you into a place of fellowship with him. And the first step is just very simple. Just acknowledge who God is and acknowledge Jesus Christ died on the cross. Ask for forgiveness of sins, and he will help you. And we'll give you that opportunity tonight to do that. If you're here tonight and you want to start with Jesus Christ, maybe you've come to church and you haven't been to church for a long time or haven't been to a church at all. Tonight, we're preaching the gospel. Gospel means good news. The good news is that the past doesn't have to dictate your future. The good news is that God is in the business of giving you a personal earthquake where your life is going to change and things can happen. The chaos and the confusion and the stuff that's happened to us, God can turn it around. God can turn it around. It just comes with one simple moment of confession and speaking the truth about your life and acknowledging who Christ is. If that's you tonight and you want to accept Jesus Christ as the answer, the true Savior of your life. If that's you, just raise your hand. Raise your hand and say, yes, that would be me. I'd like to pray or to talk with you, Pastor. Anybody here tonight, you'd raise your hand. Hallelujah. Amen. Someone raise their hand here. Thank you, Jesus. Yes. Is there anyone else who would like to say that? Yes, I want to give my life to Christ. Anyone here? We don't want to embarrass you or make you feel uncomfortable. Yes, God bless you. Yes, yes, yes. It's a step, and you step into a relationship with God. It's so wonderful. It is so good to know that the chaos and the confusion of all the nonsense in my past life, now God can use my life for something. If that's you, you raised your hand, but come up here and I would like to pray with you. Please, I invite you up here. Just step out of your seat. Come on up here. We're all going to come up later on and pray anyway. Don't be embarrassed. It's okay. We're going to pray with you tonight. God bless you, brother.
Thank you, brother. Adrian.
Thank you. God bless you. We're going to pray with you tonight and just say a simple prayer. Just say, Jesus.
Jesus.
I confess.
I'm forgiven. Because you were forsaken, and I'm accepted, you were condemned, and I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me, because you died and rose again. Sing that again. And I'm forgiven.
Hallelujah.
Because you were forsaken.
Amen. Praise the living God. Amen. If you're here tonight and you just want the chaos to come back to order, just know this. There's always going to be chaos. There's always going to be stuff. Always going to be stuff that's happening. It's the relationship that counts. I'm not tied to a philosophy. I'm not tied to some sort of methodology. I have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. And that's what this is all about. We're developing a personal relationship with Christ. And you're here tonight, maybe there's some things you need to pray about. Maybe you've been worried. And maybe you're trying to orchestrate all the chaos yourself. Let's stop worrying. Let's trust Jesus. Just come right now. We're going to open the altar up. You come and spend some time with God. We can't change certain things sometimes, so we're coming to God tonight in Jesus' name. Let's worship God.
And I'm forgiven.
Hallelujah.
Because you were forsaken, and I'm accepted. You were condemned, and I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me. Because you died and rose again. Sing amazing love. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true. And it's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you. And I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. And I'm accepted. You were condemned. And I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me, because you died and rose again. Amazing love. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true, and it's my joy to honor you. Amazing love, let's stand to our feet and sing it out. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true, and it's my joy to honor you in all I do. I'll honor you.
Hallelujah. Let's worship God. Let's give him praise tonight. Thank you, Jesus, Lord. We love you, God. We thank you, Jesus. Yes, yes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, you cannot contain resurrection power. You know, the chief scribes, the Pharisees and the Sanhedrin and all of the spiritual leaders wanted to make sure Jesus didn't rise from the dead. So they, because they had remember him mentioning it. And so they put a seal over the tomb and guarded it. And, you know, there was a whole setup of somebody trying to orchestrate chaos and make it not happen. But you can't keep resurrection isolated and down. And boom, Jesus rose from the dead. Hallelujah. You just can't get around it. And it shook everything. It didn't just shake the earth. It shook all of humanity. And that's why, you know, there's a difference with every message. Everything about Jesus is so different. It's so different than the other messages you hear out there in other religions. It's not a religion. It's a relationship. And it is a giant earthquake of idea that God is on your side. You can't try to contain the resurrection. Don't let circumstances try to contain the resurrection power of God, you know, orchestrating the chaos or whatever is happening. Just trust Jesus tonight. Can you say amen? I believe there's people tonight that you're struggling and you're trying to orchestrate things and you're wanting things to happen like you want them to. You've got to let go and let God. That's kind of like what Pastor Josh preached this morning about letting go. And, you know, we have to let go and let God actually, you know, let the power of the manifestation of the resurrection happen in your life. Can you say amen? That's really got to happen. That's really got to happen. And, you know, just I believe that God's speaking in, you know, he's touching hearts tonight. And I think that, you know, if you're here tonight, God has actually orchestrated this time. Maybe it's kind of difficult to understand everything I said, but get this one thing down pat. Don't try to manipulate things. You know, and that's something we should ask for forgiveness for. Let's trust God. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him. He will direct your steps. God's going to direct your steps. Let's pray. Father, we just thank you tonight for each one here. Lord, we ask that you would orchestrate the steps, Lord, that you have ordained for us, God. Though it looks to us like chaos and randomness, God, you are in the process of doing something good. If we will just turn our hearts to you and we will trust you, give us a better trust of you, Lord, in Jesus' name. And God's people said amen. Amen. God bless you. Amen. Amen. We're going to go home. Amen. Praise the Lord.